So I would like to start by thanking the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present my work here. The topic of my discussion today would be the generation of primordial magnetic fields in the early universe and how we can constrain, evaluate the non-Gaussianities associated with these magnetic fields. So I will show you how we can evaluate the three-point functions involving these primordial magnetic fields and primordial scalar perturbations. Now, why are we interested in primordial magnetic fields? It is because magnetic fields have been observed in our universe over a very wide range of scales, and they have a wide variety of strengths. For instance, we have observed them in galaxies and clusters of galaxies where they have where their strength is of the order of a few micrograws. And recently, they have also been detected in voids and intergalactic medium where their strength ranges between a few femtogauss to nanogauss ranges. And one of the ways to explain the prevalence of these very large-scale magnetic fields has been that they were formed from primordial seed fields. These primordial seed fields were generated during the very early universe, and then they evolved during the course of time to result in the large-scale magnetic fields that we observe today. Then the generation of these primordial magnetic fields have been studied extensively in the case of inflation. And it has been possible to arrive at scale-invariant magnetic fields in inflationary scenarios, which are in agreement with the data, with the magnetic fields that we observe today. So what I will explain here is how we can obtain such scale-invariant magnetic fields in bouncing scenarios as well. And thereafter, I will go on to discuss how we can evaluate the three-point functions involving these magnetic fields and primordial scalar perturbations. So this is the outline of my talk. At first, I will briefly discuss the generation of primordial magnetic fields in bouncing scenarios. And then I will show how we can evaluate the cross correlations of these magnetic fields with primordial scalar perturbations. And after that, I will go on to show you the effects of parity violation. That is how the introduction of a parity violating part in the electromagnetic action can change the behavior of these magnetic fields and lead to the production of helical magnetic fields. And thereafter, the cross correlations involving these helical magnetic fields with the scalar perturbations. So this is the action that we consider in order to generate these primordial magnetic fields. So it differs from the standard electromagnetic action by the presence of this non-minimal coupling function. Now, this coupling function is necessary to break the conformal invariance of the standard electromagnetic action, because if the electromagnetic action that we consider was the conformally invariant one, then the magnetic fields that were produced would decay very rapidly in an expanding universe as 1 by a square, and therefore we would not observe the large-scale magnetic fields that we in fact do observe today. Therefore, we break the conformal invariance by introducing this non-minimal coupling function. And using this action and this quantization of the vector potential, we can obtain this this equation of motion governing the evolution of the Fourier modes A bar. Here the prime denotes derivative with respect to conformal time. And it is clear from this equation that it is the non-trivial evolution of this coupling function which would lead to the evolution of the modes of the magnetic fields. And I will consider this to be the form of the scale factor driving the bouncing scenario. I will not explain the details of how we drive the bouncing scenario because you have already heard it in the previous talk. And I will only say that the case Q equal to 1 is referred to as a matter bound scenario. And although this equation can be solved for any generic form of the scale factor, but I will consider the case Q equal to 1. Now, in order to solve this equation, we need to consider some form of the non-minimal coupling function. Now, similar to what is done in the case of inflation, I will consider the coupling function to be some power of the scale factor. And using this coupling function, we can solve the equation analytically and obtain the modes. Thereafter, we can also obtain the magnetic and electric power spectra. Here, I plotted the magnetic and electric power spectra evaluated before the bounce, and here I plotted it after the bounce. For this value of the parameter n bar equal to 3 by 2, we can obtain a scale invariant magnetic power spectrum, which is what we were aiming for. And for this magnetic power spectrum, the spectral index would be 0. And what is important to note here is that the scale invariance of the magnetic power spectrum is retained across the bounds. So the bounds does not affect the scale dependence of the power spectrum. What it does is to amplify the power spectrum by a very large extent. So using these parameters, it is possible to obtain a scale-invariant magnetic power spectrum, which is in agreement with the observations in the bouncing scenario. I'm sorry. So, however, this kind of a scale invariant magnetic power spectrum can also be obtained in inflationary scenarios. Therefore, using this behavior, we cannot differentiate between the inflationary and the bouncing scenarios. So, we want to go to the next step and involve the calculate the three-point functions involving these magnetic fields. And the three-point function that we consider is this one, where we have one mode of the scalar perturbation and two of the magnetic fields. So, we evaluate this cross-correlation. We can write it in this form, and this cross correlation can be written in terms of two integrals, which I have written down here. Now, since we have the analytical forms of these modes, the electromagnetic modes, as well as the scalar modes, which I have denoted here as Fk, we can evaluate these integrals and completely analytically. And also, since we have the form of J, we can write the dj by d phi, and we can evaluate this integral. So, this on evaluation of this integral, we can obtain the total expression for the three-point function of our interest. However, another quantity that we want to evaluate is what is known as a non-Gaussianity parameter. It is basically a dimensionless combination of this three-point function to the power spectra. So, it is usually expressed as a ratio of the three-point function to the scalar and the magnetic power spectra. So, we can evaluate this non-Gaussianity parameter, which I have denoted as B and L, and I have plotted them here. In order to compare this non-Gaussianity parameter with what is obtained in inflation, I have plotted the inflationary BNL on the top and the BNL that we obtain in a bouncing scenario on the bottom. I have plotted for two different cases. This will lead to a k-squared dependence in the magnetic power spectrum, and this will lead to the scale invariant magnetic power spectrum, which is of observational interest. And we see that in both of these cases, the non-Gaussianity parameter evaluated in bounces is much larger than the corresponding non-Gaussianity parameter that we can obtain in the case of inflation. Also, for the three-point functions, it is important to consider this the squeeze limit, wherein one of the modes, the three modes that is under our consideration, out of them, one of the modes would be much smaller than the other two. And in this limit, this small mode would exit first because it has the largest wavelength, and it would freeze on super-Hubble scales. And in this limit, we can express the three-point function in terms of the two-point functions. Such a relation is usually known as the consistency relation. And for the three-point function of our interest here, I can express it in terms of the non-Gaussianity parameter BNL as BNL equal to 2NB minus 8, where NB is the spectral index of the magnetic field. So, for a scale invariant magnetic field, BNL should be of the order of 8. And for the other case we have considered, where NB is 2, BNL should be of the order of 4. Now, if we just go back here, we see that for the inflationary scenario, in the squeeze limit here, BNL is of the order of 4 for NB equal to 2 and of the order of 8 for NB equal to 0. So, the consistency relation is satisfied for BNL in the inflationary scenario. However, in neither of the bouncing scenarios, the consistency relation is satisfied. This is because the bounces generate a very large amount of non-Gaussianity, and this points to a very stark contrast between the three-point functions evaluated in the inflationary and the bouncing scenarios. Now, what we can do is to introduce a small parity violating part in the standard electromagnetic reaction that we had considered before, with the parity violating parameter being denoted by gamma. We will work with gamma equal to 2, which is rather small. And we can evaluate, using this form of the action, we can again evaluate the electromagnetic modes, which would now be denoted as AK sigma, with sigma being plus and minus, corresponding to the positive and negative helicity modes. Here I plotted this evolution of these modes in terms of the E folds, because I have considered D sitter inflation here. And this has been evaluated numerically, and we see that right after Hubble exit, which is denoted by this black vertical line in both of these plots, the modes, the positive and negative, this is the positive one, this is the negative one, the positive and negative helicity modes evolve very differently. And we would like to see how this evolution can affect the three-point function. So again, we evaluate the integrals and the three-point function that I had already shown before, and also evaluate the non-Gaussianity parameter BNL, and compare it with the non-helical case, which I have plotted on top, and this is the helical case. We see that again in the helical case, for both of the scenarios under consideration, the presence of the helicity part in the action introduces a very large amount of non-Gaussianity in this three-point function. And it is much larger compared to what we obtain in inflation, but in the non-helical case, in both of the scenarios, which lead to NB equal to 2 here and the scale invariant case here. So we can conclude that the presence of even a small amount of helicity can introduce a very large amount of non-Gaussianity in this three-point function. So to summarize, we have been able to obtain scale invariant magnetic fields of observable strengths over the ranges of cosmological interest in a matter bound scenario, and we have shown that the shapes of the spectra are preserved across the bounds. Then we have evaluated the cross correlation involving these primordial magnetic fields and scalar perturbations in these matter bounds, and we see that it leads to a very large amount of non-Gaussianities in the bouncing scenario. And then we have numerically evaluated this cross correlation involving the primordial helical magnetic fields and the perturbations in the scalar field in DC to inflation, and we have shown that the presence of helicity again significantly boosts the amplitude of the non-Gaussianities. Thank you.
Thank you, Debika. Questions? Yeah, Aseem.
Your calculation is perturbative. You're working at third order. But then if you see dimensionless numbers with amplitudes 10 to the 46, 10 to the 51, doesn't that mean that the perturbative ansatz is not valid?
Okay, so the thing is, at the level of the power spectrum, the modes that lead to this large non-Gaussianities will lead to the power spectrum that is seen on observation by observations. So we have fixed the parameters of the model according to the power spectrum that we observed, and using those parameters, when we evaluate the non-Gaussianities, they turn out to be very large. So we think that this is because if we plot the evolution of the modes, they grow very rapidly in the contracting phase, and that would lead to a significant contribution to the non-Gaussianities.
So I wanted to ask you, what's the understanding of why helical fields produce large non-Gaussianities? Is there some intuitive explanation or some reason for that? I mean.
One reason is that the helical fields are amplified much more compared to the non-helical case. So if you plot the non-helical evolution of the non-helical modes in this plot corresponding to these values of the parameters, you would see that in this case, the negative helicity mode is amplified more. So it is amplified much more. So I think that it is because of the amplification of the helical modes relative to the non-helical modes that leads to the large non-Gaussianities.
Thank you.
Okay, any further questions? If not, let's thank Debika again, as well as all the speakers of this session.